nightmare come to life. I'm a girl who you can't shut up. There's not a guy big enough can handle this mouth. I'm gonna tell everyone what you did to me. It was the middle of the night in my house. It was the middle of the night in my house. It was the middle of the night in my house. It was the middle of the night in my house. It was the middle of the night in my house. Only I wasn't dreaming. I wasn't dreaming. I don't really think I was dreaming. I really think something happened in that house. It was the middle of the night in my house. It was the middle of the night in my house. I am your worst nightmare come to life.
I discovered Kathy Acker, the American writer, and I went to this workshop that she did, and she told me, why do you want to write? And I said, because nobody has ever listened to me my whole life, and I have all this stuff that I want to say. And she said, then why are you doing spoken word? You should be in a band, because nobody goes to spoken word, but people go to see bands. So I went home and I started a band.
Bikini Kill wasn't just the best girl band, they were the best band.
Kathleen's voice was so strong and so powerful and so punk.
This was not a girl who was going to fade into the background.
Kathleen was like a beam of light through the entire crowd that just like infused everyone with revolution.
It's all about speaking what's unspoken, screaming what's unspoken, and that's what Kathleen was never afraid to do.
Kathleen Hanna is an amazing singer, activist, who I think changed a lot of girls' lives because she created a new role model that was like sexy and tough and angry and funny and all of those things at once.
Kathleen can sound arrestingly young, but then it just makes the words like have more of an impact, especially when she's singing about topics like rape.
The big question is, in the last few years, like, why she hasn't been doing more.
What happened? Why did she, like, why has she forsaken us, you know? Like, what did we do that was so bad?
Do you know why she stopped performing in 2005?
No, I don't, actually.
Well, it's so all-encompassing of a question, you know? There's so much to ask.
These are my origin stories. I have a few I can flip through because things never really begin at the beginning.
I was born in Portland, Oregon. My mom was a nurse. My dad was a pipe fitter. My sister's 4 years older than me.
I mean, I already knew I was going to be some kind of artist. I just didn't know what kind.
I used to do like musical theater and dance and stuff when I was younger. One time I did this song and dance thing and everybody, you know, applauded and it was like, yay, yay, and we were in the car going back to our house and my dad goes, we should all go out and get ice cream. And I was all happy because I made my dad proud. And then he goes, because anybody who can make such a fool of themselves in front of so many people deserves an ice cream. And I totally like sat in the back of the car and cried.
My mom and I had a really specific relationship.
She's totally sadistic and funny. And I say that with like
love and generosity towards her in my heart. One of my first big memories was when my mom heard about this thing, the trust game. It's like a trust building exercise. And she's like, I'm gonna get on my knees and I'm gonna fall backwards and you catch me. And then you stand up and you fall backwards and I'll catch you. So she falls backwards and like, I catch her. And then I fall back and my mom steps out of the way and lets me fall. And I look up from the carpet and my mom's standing over me laughing at me. And she says, let that be a lesson to you. Don't trust anyone, not even your own mother.
I moved a lot as a kid. We moved every 3 years. And when I was 14, we moved all the way across the country from Maryland to the Pacific Northwest. I went to college at the Evergreen State College in Olympia, Washington. And I studied photography.
That's when I first met Kathleen Hanna. She literally made an entrance because I remember she was late for class. I guess my first impressions were she reminded me of a young Elizabeth Taylor.
Tammy Rae was just the punkest thing I'd ever seen and had all these ideas and like taught me about Sonic Youth and Pixies, stuff I didn't know about.
We were all trying to make feminist work that was kind of inspired by Jenny Holzer and Barbara Kruger. And
you know, we were taking these photo classes and
when we would bring in our work, we were treated like we were crazy. I made work about sexism. I took pictures from books I found in the library. So I did this thing that juxtaposed the images of the women and then this picture of the little girl in this like portrait. And it said, pretend you like it on her. And then it said, believe you like it on the housewives. Because my work was censored from the college, we started an art gallery in like an old garage, and it was called Brecca Muse, and it was like a feminist art space that me and my friends started.
I think we were coming into a really heightened level of awareness in terms of feminism and sexist representation of women. A really very clear memory I have of Kathleen showing me a copy of a copy of an article from Time magazine, Is Feminism Dead? We both got really emotional. Like, it couldn't be dead because we were living it. We were doing it and thinking it and feeling it. You know, how could it be dead?
I was working on a project, fashion show, where I made all the clothes for a fashion show and I silkscreened all these fabrics and stuff using photography. And I was working late at night in the lab, and while I was at work, my best friend, she was assaulted in our house. She went in her room and fell asleep, and she woke up and he was standing in her doorway. And he grabbed her by the neck and he started dragging her up the stairs. And he was saying shit like, I'm gonna rape you, then I'm gonna kill you. And she was actually a music major, and it was the first time she was writing her own symphony. And she told me that when she was on the stairs, she thought, I'm gonna finish my fucking symphony. And she just flipped out and just like punched him and got loose and got away. And I came home and she was like all beat up. I was like, I have to make sure this never happens again. I made a dress that said, as he drug her upstairs by her neck, I didn't even want to finish, but she was like, you have to finish it. So I ended up making that project was just about me being able to finish something. And then I realized in the middle of it, it wasn't just about that. It was, I had to take this thing that had happened to my friend and had affected me and put it into my work. Mm-hmm. I couldn't keep it out. Like, it was just totally impossible for me to keep it out.
I mean, I remember the first time I saw her, I was like, who is this person that she just has like this commanding presence? She's just like, yes, I'm doing a fashion show in the library building. You know what I mean? It was like, we're only 18. Like, you know what I mean? What are you doing?
Kathleen and I, we were both going to Evergreen State College.
Our friends had this idea that was like called the Revolution Girl Style now. Now it was sort of like our idea of like, let's just, you know, let's get all these girls to learn how to play instruments.
I'd read Jigsaw, Toby's fanzine.
And she was one of the only girls I knew around who was talking about feminism and punk rock kind of in the same sentence.
Toby was like, Kathy, do you know how to play guitar or something? I was like, no. She's like, do you know how to play bass? Like, no. She's like, do you want to start a band with me? I was like, okay. Toby was like, I think we should ask this girl Kathleen to be the singer. I was like, yeah, we should. Because she's perfect to be a singer. You know, she's, you couldn't get a better singer. You couldn't ask for a better front person. And we all got together and started playing at Toby's parents' house. It was just the three of us for like months and months. We wanted a girl guitar player, but we just couldn't do it. You know, we would have people come and play with us. But it just didn't work.
And then Toby was kind of like, I think we should ask my friend Bill. And I'm like, oh, I guess we can try it. And then that was it.
We're Bikini Kill, and we want revolution. Girl style!
Hey, girl friend! I got a proposition, girls, something like this. Tell you to do what you want. Tell you to be who you will. Tell you to cry right out loud. You got so emotional, baby.
What everybody said about us was that we couldn't play our instruments. And we said, and? We were a young band getting a ton of attention in a scene where there were a ton of bands and everybody wanted attention. And we didn't realize it at the time because we weren't really that careerist. We didn't give a shit. We weren't making money. We knew we were never gonna make money. And it was really important that we made our music. We were on a mission, and we were gonna do what we did, whether we got attention or not. We were spreading the message on the road at our shows, you know, handing out flyers, telling people what we were doing. Our fanzines were all about feminism and political issues.
We just tried to take feminist stuff that we read in books and then filter it through a punk rock lens.
Just wait.
Zoom in on that.
In 100 years, this footage will be worth quite a bit of money. Not fancy. Buy me. Pretty cover. Gonna be red.
It's gonna be red. Giving me a flyer at a show, handing it to me and smiling at me, that's as much of the way Kathleen communicates as when she's on stage singing really powerful lyrics.
It was so great. You know, she just presented all of that, like, kapow. Here I am, and I'm gonna talk like this, and I'm gonna sound like a Valley Girl, and what I'm gonna say is actually totally brilliant, and you have to take me seriously.
I got a Valley Girl accent from the Valley Girl Handbook, and me and my best friend Angela Cheever, we lived in Maryland, and we desperately wanted to be the kind of girls who had credit cards. I think we thought it made us sound like we were, like, rich. We thought it was like a posh accent.
It goes to show that you can be just like, you know, just, I don't know, some Valley Girl, and you still can be smart and have feminist ideas, and you still should be listened to.
It was an exciting moment for a lot of young women, especially. It was speaking to women and wanting to connect with women, and that, I think, is why the intervention of Bikini Kill was really necessary.
It was like basically me and Toby and Kathy were like, we're gonna take over the punk rock scene for feminists.
She was like 5'4" and about women. Her thing, their thing. But they have Billy. He's a boy. But he was like, all boys in around her were kind of just, we kind of need you to do some shit, so you just do the shit, because we are doing the talking.
Kathleen was very clear and didn't hold back.
This is for all the fuckers!
She was just screaming at the top of her lungs. There's veins sticking out of her neck. It was the first time I'd seen a woman on stage completely angry, aggressive, doing stuff that you kind of see guys do. And it was amazing.
Somebody had to be Bikini Kill. Like, it had to happen, or else we would all have starved to death culturally. It had to happen, and there they were.
All girls to the front. I'm not kidding.
Girls to the front. That is the thing that never happened before. Men could be in the room, but men could never dominate the room. It was a flip of the script that blew people's minds. All of that incredibly rich stuff that made punk what it was had just been tamped down by the boy mosh pit, you know?
Right when Bikini Kill started, right when grunge was like going off the hook, right when Nirvana was exploding, it was a wild scene. And it was very physical, violent, like all the moshing and all that stuff. These young women who wanted to be a part of the scene, like physically wanted to go to these shows, wanted to get into this punk rock scene, we physically were getting shoved.
Sick to death for going to gigs and coming back with bruises and broken ribs. It's not fair because lads get everything, yeah? They're allowed to do what they want and we have to stand in the background.
The problem with our shows, a lot of times, a lot of guys will get really out of control and start like beating everybody up.
The more girls up front, the better. And if anybody is fucking with you at this show, because of certain reasons, and you need to come up front and sit on the stage and get away from them and let us know, because it shouldn't just be one person in the crowd's responsibility to deal with fuckers.
Every show we played was like a war. Guys would try to beat us up and stuff, you know, like it was really violent, and we just play these crazy places like, you know, bowling alleys, and they cram like 600 people in there and stuff, you know, no security.
More girls would stand at the front of our shows a lot of times just because we needed to be protected. And I felt like if there was a row of girls in front of them, I would be safe.
But some of the men were slamming into the women in the front. And, you know, it was just like, our shows aren't the place for that.
There physically was not the space for young women to be safe at these shows. And that was a huge part of what Kathleen did, was to say that's unacceptable.
You know, we got a fucking right to be hostile. And I'm not going to sit around and be peace and love with somebody's fucking boot on my neck.
Fuck you, you're gonna change now, and if you don't fucking pick up the gentle hint, we're gonna fucking very clearly direct you as to what to do.
Get off my stage.
It was shocking. They just weren't expecting this kind of orders to come from that size of a person, that gender of a person, in a fucking dress.
I don't think it's a problem because most of the girls ask for it.
How did they ask for it?
The way they act, the way they... I can't say the way they dress because that's their own personal choice, but some gung-ho, this butt rocker bitch is walking down the street. They're asking for it and they deny it, but it's true.
When I started writing the book, the more that I researched, the more respect I got for kind of what a good thinker Kathleen is and how good she was at like crystallizing a widely held feeling into a really irresistible like artistic format.
Like some people have certain things they want to do and this is just what I want to do, and if everybody doesn't want to listen then they can go away.
She would instruct people, here's a little snippet from her fanzine, maybe if you could move to the back. Like it was this very, it was kind of an empowering and surreal experience, you know, because you weren't really used to being talked to from the stage.
Hi. Liberated from the cage. That was a metaphor. I hear they have go-go dancers here in this cage sometimes. Well, fuck you!
It's like, oh, music is supposed to be escapist. And it wasn't. It was grounding it. It was making, like, music a voice for a lot of people that hadn't been heard before.
I remember the song Feels Blind. All the doves that pass through my eyes have a stickiness to their wings. How does it feel? Feels blind. What have you taught me? This world has taught me nothing. I mean, I'm still like getting shivers when I think about those words. The way that Kathleen delivered that line was so angry. It was so outside the realm of how a young woman is supposed to act. It was really raw.
Stories of abuse, emotional violence, sexism that were just bubbling around, they brought that out in the open. She wanted to talk about this stuff. You know, you're objectifying women, what does that mean? What does that do to my body? You know, you're celebrating a certain kind of woman, what does that do if I don't fit into that mold?
You know, breaking down the rules of what a girl has to be or not, you know? I mean, even she has it in the songs, you know, the dirty nails and not being the perfect big-titted girl.
I mean, I remember thinking that each person in the band was incredibly powerful and interesting to watch. And we were doing some dates with Nirvana. I think Toby was still involved with Kurt.
Kurt has a history with Bikini Kill. He's very connected to Kathleen and what she was doing. Any good biography of Kurt Cobain now acknowledges that he didn't come out of Hesher Rock in the Pacific Northwest. He came out of feminist art punk, you know, and he said it himself at that time.
Kurt was a very charismatic person. I kind of started hanging out with him because I had a boyfriend who became a crackhead, and then he started like stalking me. And I was known as a feminist, and I felt like I couldn't ask for help from people because I thought that they'd think she's making too big of a deal out of it because she's a feminist. And the only person who believed me was my friend Kurt. I was his friend for life at that moment. I mean, he stuck up for me. He was like the only person that stuck up for me. I wrote, "Kurt smells like Teen Spirit" on the wall of his apartment after we spray painted on the side of a fake abortion clinic. Kurt spray painted "God is gay." We were so wasted, so wasted, super fucking wasted. And the next day, I swore off alcohol and I didn't drink for 6 years.
What hopes, I guess, do you have for Bikini Kill and for the Olympia scene in general?
We hope to leave Olympia. We hope to abandon the Olympia scene.
Olympia is a really great scene in terms of community, but in terms of politics, it was kind of difficult for us. We thought it'd be cool if we moved to DC, where there already was a precedent for bands like us. Not really feminist bands, but at least bands that were interested in what was going on in the world.
So we moved with our friends from the band Bratmobile, and that's where the whole Riot Girl thing really started.
There were all these things in the late 80s and early 90s, like Anita Hill, Clarence Thomas, the William Kennedy Smith rape trial. There were things that happened all in a really quick succession that our generation, so people who were like 18 and 19 in the late 80s, experienced it, and we knew that they were wrong.
There was utter pandemonium outside the university building as ambulances carted away the injured. Police have now confirmed 14 students dead, all women. Another dozen people were hurt, caught in a rampage that witnesses called a human hunt, with the gunman yelling, "I want women."
Our friend Jen Smith said, "You know what we need? We need a girl riot."
Toby had talked about Angry Girl with many R's. The combination of what Jen Smith said and Toby said became Riot Girl.
So we made a zine called Riot Girl.
The original Riot Girl zine, it was mostly Kathleen Hanna, Allison Wolf, and Molly Newman from Bratmobile, Jen Smith, and Toby Vail, the drummer of Bikini Kill.
Allison and I went to a punk show with a clipboard, and we just walked up to girls and we were like, "We want to have an all-girl meeting where we just talk maybe about starting a magazine or doing projects, playing punk music and starting a scene and kind of taking over." We got to do the first Riot Girl meeting at Positive Force House. The first meeting was like, it's pretty intense. And as it turned out, they just wanted to hang out and talk without men being there.
They wanted to talk about sexual abuse. They wanted to talk about coming out and get information and share information with each other.
I actually wrote a Riot Girl manifesto in the Bikini Kill fanzine called Girl Power. And I wrote what I dreamed Riot Girl could be and encouraged other girls and women to write their manifestos of what they wanted Riot Girl to be. The idea was that any woman anywhere could take that name and use it and create anything she wanted. We didn't brand it or copyright it or anything like that. It belonged to everybody.
All of us felt like, look, here's some ideas, take it and run with it.
Other girls started Riot Girls all around the country.
Feminism had been kind of scared of pop culture music. It was really good at protesting it and not good at making it. And so Riot Girl was making it. It was making zines and it was making rock bands and it was speaking to people. And Kathleen was a major motivator of that. First wave of feminism began in 1848, the Seneca Falls Conference. It was the first time that women organized on behalf of themselves. They all happened to be abolitionists. They were opposing slavery. It was a movement for human rights, but they weren't equal members of this movement. So they turned their race consciousness on themselves and their organizing skills on themselves and said, we need our own independent movement for our own rights. So that first wave of the women's movement focused itself on citizenship, and that's most symbolized by the vote. there was a swell of activism again, based coming out of the civil rights movement and the peace movement and the free speech movement. So the women who were part of these movements eventually turned their race consciousness on themselves and said, we need to have our own independent movement for our rights, for equality to be treated as full human beings. The biggest goal of the second wave was equality. That was the surge of activism that was the second wave. Rebecca Walker's article, Becoming the Third Wave, so she used that term, and that's because she, her mother was Alice Walker, and she was a daughter of the second wave, and she was trying to find a way to say, we're different, but we're part of this history.
Third Wave was founded in response to a feeling on college campuses in 1992 that feminism was in some ways dead, irrelevant, that women of my generation were apathetic, not desirous of working on behalf of women's empowerment.
You can't overstate her importance to third wave feminism. She was incredibly inspiring. She was kind of the first person to come forth and say, this is what feminism is going to look like, and we don't take your bullshit patriarchs and rapists. And it was incredibly exciting.
I mean, more than any other person that I've ever met, Kathleen was a leader.
I mean, a lot of what we saw Riot Girl as doing was like girls going back to like their girlhood and reclaiming girlhood that has been taken away from them, that has been directed down some bullshit path where they're like, I'm actually gonna be a little girl that has power now. I'm gonna relive that part so that I can then direct my whole growing up experience from there, from point A.
The third wave cliche is like a hot, angry, bisexual girl who is wearing a mini dress with combat boots. I mean, there's like a lot of, I think, attempting to reconcile a lot of extremes that are in all of us.
Yes, she totally used her sexuality. I love that. Use it, whatever we got. You gonna give me some shit? You gonna define me? You're gonna tell me what I am? Okay, great, I'm that.
Being a stripper is what let me be in Bikini Kill. Do I wish that there was a job that paid me that amount of money and that gave me that flexibility where I didn't have to take my clothes off? Sure, of course I do, but it didn't exist and I wanted to make music. And I worked at McDonald's and I was a vegetarian. And I just felt like it was the same thing. I was a feminist and I worked at a strip bar.
Hey, we're Bikini Kill. Everybody knows what to do. I don't need to tell you.
We played at the Capitol with Fugazi. It was around like the time of the abortion march, and so it was like abortion without apology. The DC music has that monumental sound that maybe does come from living in the Capitol. It's like this big feeling that it's really important, that what we're doing is super important. We're so close to like the seat of power. And then these bands are making this huge sounding music, but about stuff that's totally different than what the politicians are doing.
You're saying that I don't know.
A USA Today reporter came and then wrote this really condescending thing about what we were doing and focused on what our clothes look like and what our bodies look like. And we must all be sexual abuse survivors because we're singing about rape, and therefore, you know, nobody has any imagination or knows anybody who's had things happen to them. So we must all have had these tragic histories. It was really frustrating to a lot of us, especially that another woman would write something that we thought was so stupid. So we just decided to stop thinking about it and talking about it and just not answering the phone when journalists called. And that was what everybody called a press blackout.
They're like, no, actually, you're not going to fucking co-opt this fucking revolution, fuck you. It's actually not going to be televised. That was genius.
It was very savvy. And it was something that was thinking much bigger than a lot of us did.
People involved with Riot Girl were reluctant to do
interviews with mainstream press or Rolling Stone or, you know, people who got interested in, got wind of the movement.
It's hard to see yourself written about or talked about in a third person or some removed context. It's always just going to seem wrong somehow. The facts are wrong. Something's wrong. It's always wrong. It was also for her own self-preservation and protection because people were just tearing her apart publicly and revealing a lot of personal things about her that she hadn't chosen to reveal.
How things become just so distorted and taken out of their hands.
There was an article in the Washington Post, and it said that my father raped me. And I never spoke to a reporter. I've never asserted that. And I will say right now on camera, my father did not rape me. My father was sexually inappropriate. He wasn't a great father. He was physically and verbally abusive at times, but he did not physically rape me. I make a distinction between sexual inappropriateness and abuse in my mind because I know other people's stories that are super horrific and like way more horrific than mine. And that just isn't my story. And I was really upset when it said that. And it taught me a big lesson about how a lot of reporters don't fact check anything. Instead of being like, you know, sitting around being upset about it, I thought it was really important that I kept making music and that I went on tour and that other girls got to hear what we were making.
I'd never seen Bikini Kill play until Somersault Tour. Mike from my band, he had a Bikini Kill 7-inch, and it was one of those things like, oh shit, you gotta hear this record. And then his wife Tamara, who's a filmmaker, interviewed Kathleen. We were watching this thing that she made, and it was fucking Kathleen being interviewed wearing a ski mask in like a stairwell somewhere, and I was like, what the fuck is going on? This is some serious shit. And so I was very interested.
I did a video called No Alternative Girls. And Kathleen Hanna was in it, and she was doing a media blackout at the time, so she said she would appear in the video, but she wouldn't let her face be in it, so she wore this ski mask. And then I worked with her again with Sonic Youth when we did the video for Bull in the Heather. And so when Bikini Kill was on tour, Kathleen was there, and Adam was going through this terrible breakup. I was totally trying to get them together because I thought they would be friends at least, but also they had so much in common, it seemed to me. And I thought Kathleen would be somebody really good for Adam to talk to. So,
yeah, that was interesting. I mean, I wanted to be encouraging, but I was also, you know, afraid.
Bikini Kill was just super punk rock, and then it reminded me of, like, you know, when I was in a hardcore band when I was a kid, that feeling of just like, we'll just do whatever we feel like doing. And that was awesome to see. To see this, you know, like, punk group, and it was all the girls in front and all just girls just all on the stage. And, you know, for guys shows, it's like, the fuck off my stage, you know what I mean? And then Kathleen was just like a force, like a full-on force. I was gonna say like a car accident, you can't look away. But you know what I mean? I mean a good car accident. I didn't mean it, you know. You're just like, what the fuck? We went skateboarding one night in Adelaide. I didn't realize, she was very sneaky, I guess. And she was like, hey, who wants to go skateboarding? You know, and I was like, I'll go skateboarding.
Yeah.
can see me in the mirror.
Hey, Kathleen.
Hmm?
Come on, just make me dry myself.
What's going on?
I'm not telling you.
Dry yourself.
Would you get out of here?
Dry yourself.
Initially, it was really difficult weaving their worlds together, but not because they didn't have stuff in common, but just because of that. Yeah, what will my friends think, or my community, or something?
I was dating somebody who like wrote, you know, girls, girls, girls do my laundry and shit like that in the 80s. So I was like, what does this mean that I'm a feminist artist and I'm dating this person and I'm so in love with him? And it was like, I realized that you can't legislate kind of who you fall in love with. Like, I was totally in love with him and there was no way I was not going to hang out with him. I'm sure it made it a little exciting and like risky feeling, but also it just really opened my eyes that you kind of fall in love with who you fall in love with. And I couldn't do anything about it. But I freak out.
After all of the whole tour happened, they had this long distance relationship where they were only communicating through the phone or, you know, writing each other.
There was a time period where we weren't like, we didn't do stuff in public and we were really private, but that was kind of both of our choices. So it wasn't really like we were hiding, but I could see how it appeared that way.
The thing is about Bikini Kill, they were looked at and scrutinized so closely and had this certain level of celebrity, but they were still barely making rent. They were still in a crappy van that could easily break down. They were still sleeping on strangers' floors.
It gets rough on tour sometimes. We don't have $1 million, we don't sleep in Hilton hotels. So it's cool if you want to treat us like we're assholes just because we're tired.
Bikini Kill was just like in this weird disarray and there was a lot of tension between us. You know, we'd all gotten into like weird roles of who we were in that band and it was kind of just impossible to get out of them.
What is Bikini Kill? Bikini Kill is forever in flux and it's completely impossible for us to discuss it because it's always changing and that's why it's really hard for us to do interviews and also because all four of us don't agree on anything ever. And it's really difficult to sort out like what you can actually say about it.
Our relationships as four people disintegrated because we weren't ever looking at each other and dealing with the problems that each of us had.
I was in Bikini Kill for like 8 years. It's a long time for a girl band. And to be under the magnifying glass and kind of pinned to wax how we were, it was a really, really long time.
Her work seemed to make her feel isolated more, and like Reaction, her band, seemed to make her feel like she was set apart from her bandmates and set apart from the girls in Riot Girl and set apart from other people in the punk scene. While at the same time, her music and her art was bringing people together so much.
I think Kathleen struggled with the leadership role at times. She had a lot of responsibility that came with that. She definitely struggled with those, the kind of implications that much fame has for a person.
Can you speak a little louder? I'm having trouble.
Well, I didn't want to be the leader or singled out. And I mean, I'm sure that Gloria can commiserate with the position of like getting a really negative attention from the media. And it feels like you're kind of getting kicked in the face by both sides.
On the one hand, I was working in the media. On the other hand, I was trying to avoid, being singled out. It wasn't always successful. It's not always under your control, but I think the challenge is to figure out how to use it to convey some message.
I'm not willing to deal with the mainstream anymore when they're constantly asking me questions about sexual abuse, about if I've been a stripper, if I haven't been a stripper, constantly just completely sexist shit, where they're trying to turn the band that I'm in and the projects I'm involved with against other women who I respect in the community, coming up, you know, saying so-and-so said so-and-so about you to get you to make, you know, slag off another woman so that they can print, you know, Kathleen Hanna doesn't like PJ Harvey or, you know, like whatever, and creating all these schisms because it sells papers.
This is the thing that's happened ever since the beginning of time. You ask a woman about another woman and try to get her to say something bad, and then you make the article all about a catfight.
Lollapalooza news, meanwhile, Courtney Love, one of the tour's headliners this year with her band Hole, was officially charged with fourth-degree assault this week for, as she acknowledged in a recent online rant, punching out Bikini Kill singer Kathleen Hanna backstage at a Lollapalooza show on July 4th, an incident first reported, also online, by Thurston Moore of the bill-topping Sonic Youth.
We did Lollapalooza. Kathleen was there, and she was standing on the stage watching us, and Courtney Love basically just punched her in the face, and that was the beginning of our tour.
I mean, there's the whole Lollapalooza punching Courtney Love thing. No, Courtney Love punched her. See, I can't trust the internet.
That's the whole thing that pissed me off, is that later people were like, they fought. There was this rivalry and they fought. It's like, dude, I was standing there watching a band and Courtney walked up and attacked me.
I think people don't realize that Kathleen and Courtney didn't know each other.
It's a real bummer to be assaulted. It sucks. It's not cool. It's a real bummer if you're a feminist and you're assaulted by another woman, because it's just kind of heartbreaking. Especially women who are kind of hoping you guys could be some kind of allies.
I think a lot of people who are close to Kathleen have worried about her safety for a variety of reasons. You know, she's experienced violence towards her in really aggressive ways that nobody should have to experience.
Hatred for Bikini Kill and specifically Kathleen.
She would get letters from guys that were like, you need to die. They just wanted to like stamp her out. And I don't know why.
I remember things like that would happen and I would feel totally shitty. And I was just like, I had kids writing me saying like, you know, I was gonna kill myself and I got your record and you saved my life. And all I could say back is like, you saved my life too, because I couldn't have made it through all of the, not criticism, but all the hate that got thrown my way.
I made a record called Julie Ruin that was a solo record. And I made it kind of to escape what had happened to me. And so I made it under an assumed name. In Bikini Kill, I was singing to an elusive asshole male that was fucking the world over, and I was allowing other women to watch me do that, and I really wanted to start directly singing to other women.
For Kathleen's music to grow in directions toward electronic music completely makes sense to me. When you've disconnected from your community or lost your community, it's amazing if you can seize the means of technology yourself.
I went to visit Kathleen, and we went to some music shop. They had a Dramatics drum machine. Kathleen bought this drum machine for $40. Then she recorded like the whole fucking Julie Ruin record. That record is a fucking masterpiece.
It was this whole new side of Kathleen Hanna. It's like you know someone, they're your friend, but they never opened up their scrapbook and showed you what really made them who they are. That's what Julie Ruin started to do for those of us who are interested in Kathleen Hanna.
I felt like a lot of my graphic sensibility came out in it, because using samples, it's very cut and paste. Making a fanzine for me was always being in my room by myself and cutting stuff and having this really specific relationship to my materials that was not mediated by anybody else.
She was figuring everything out for herself.
It sounded lo-fi and on purpose lo-fi. And just really smart.
Sounds like you can hear a human being's fingers all over it. It sounds like bedroom culture. It sounds like something a girl made in her bedroom. Girls' bedrooms sometimes can be this space of real creativity. The problem is that these bedrooms are all cut off from each other. So how do you take that bedroom that you're cut off from all the other girls who are secretly in their bedroom writing secret things or making secret songs? I wanted the Julie Ruin record to sound like a girl from her bedroom made this record, but then didn't just throw it away, or it wasn't just in her diary, but she took it out and shared it with people.
How many times I made you cry? You can tell anyone anything you want. If you're gonna talk about how I deserve what you did, you can look now, cause I'm gone.
For me, the Julie Ruin record is what really changed Kathleen in terms of her, like, she was in a band, she was in this band Bikini Kill, and they did all this fucking stuff, and she made this record Julie Ruin, and she's like, now I'm a musician. Fuck it.
Julie Ruin was kind of the template, you know, the foundation stone. And then La Tigre was the beginning of a whole new world.
I decided I wanted to move to Portland because I had to get out of Olympia because it was driving me crazy.
I gave Kathleen my zine. I mean, I don't know if you call that like meeting her. I just like said hi and gave it to her at a show at the X-Ray Cafe in Portland.
I read Joe's fanzine and I was like, this is the best fanzine I've read ever. She has to be my new best friend.
Basically, I spent a whole day like just driving around looking for her.
She was like, you're gonna be my friend. We're gonna be in a band. And that's that. And I was like, okay.
My original idea was try and make the Julie Ruin record into a stage show. I never would have been in a band again in my whole life. I'm convinced of it if it wasn't for my friendship with Johanna. Because I was really burnt out and sad. I was really depressed.
I remember sitting in my car and it was raining with Joe, and I just like looked at her and started crying, and I just told her everything.
We were like, let's just erase it off from our heads and be happy. Let's just pretend it never ever happened in our whole lives, that all this bad shit didn't happen, and what would we make? And we were like, we'd make something celebrating everything we have. We kept saying, what are the good things? What are the good things?
I started realizing that I should move to New York.
We didn't really have a place to stay exactly.
We were both really broke. I mean, really broke. I just moved to New York with $400.
There's no way I could have afforded rent, so I was really fortunate that I had a boyfriend who had an apartment and would let me stay with him.
You know, I was psyched about everything. I was psyched about riding the subway, going to the museum, being near Johanna, being with Adam. Everything was good again for me. And then the Woodstock thing happened.
Woodstock 99.
This is a very dangerous situation.
It was disgusting. I was molested.
I was stomping around the apartment pissed off. And he was stomping around the apartment pissed off.
8 rapes and sexual assaults during the festival were reported.
I was like, why don't you say something at your acceptance speech? And then we sat down and we worked on writing something, and then he did it.
I read in the news and heard from my friends all about the sexual assaults and the rapes that went down at Woodstock 99. It made me feel really sad and angry. Okay?
When he started talking about something real amongst all of this completely superficial bullshit, the room just, it was like, like everything changed. The whole room, it felt so who farted, like beyond who farted.
Are you all there? Okay. Y'all remember that? Woodstock?
It definitely sucked the party out of the room, that's for sure, for a minute. But I'm sure somebody, you know, got up. I'm sure, you know, Uncle Cracker got up and played some awesome song and the audience was back.
Kathleen had a bass and she really wanted to play drums. I had bought a sampler. I was interested in making sample-based electronic music.
Jo believed in me so much that she went down in this dingy basement and wrote with me every single day.
Things shifted with JD joining La Tigre.
I remember getting a call from Kathleen. She was like, we're practicing and we want to know if you want to do our slides. We went on like a 2-week tour of the East Coast, and she was like, you're a performer, you really need to be on stage. During that tour, Kathleen was like, will you be in our band? And I was like, yeah.
The second she was on stage, she just had such a great stage presence.
We were like the feminist party band. Our whole ethic was about making something that had politically radical content that you could dance to.
Kathleen's voice was beautiful. She's like at that perfect age at that point to have like this full, resonant, amazing, powerful voice. La Tigre seemed like it was much more sophisticated and mature. It understood what people needed at that time in terms of danceability, still maintaining really interesting message, a message of non-competition, of a culture of praise, but sophisticated in understanding what a good pop song is. Bikini Kill understood song structure too, but La Tigra just like fucking nailed it.
We did like a really long tour after This Island was released, and it was a world tour, a year and a half. We went to Australia, we went to Japan, we did the US and Europe and everything. Take a good look.
La Tigra moved out into like bigger and bigger circles, embrace more and more of humanity and all the issues. And what does it really mean to be a feminist? It means that you pay attention to all different kinds of oppression and you stand up for all those people that don't have a voice, whether they're trans or people of color or class, race, gender, sexuality, everything. She did that. And then the next challenge is like, how do you do that on a personal level?
All of a sudden in North Carolina, I lost my voice, and at soundcheck, I lost pitch. I always think of it as a bullet, kind of like my voice is a bullet, and there's like a note that I want to hit that's here or the tier or here or whatever, and then the breath is like the bullet coming out of my mouth and it's going to hit the target. Well, I was like, I could get the breath, but then the bullet would just go, wow, like I couldn't hit the target. I was terrified, I couldn't believe it. So we canceled the show in North Carolina. And I went back to New York and found a throat specialist. It's actually really traumatic to think, to when I think about it, because it was like, you know, singing is my life. Like it's everything to me. When you have a sore throat, you have a sore throat. But once the adrenaline would kick in for a show, I didn't ever feel any pain. I never felt pain on stage ever. I mean,
no matter how bad I felt, once I was on stage and the lights hit me, I was fine.
When I'm playing music, I don't feel anything bad. So enmeshed in our band that that's all we did. It was all band. And I'd been in that mode of every band I'd done was just a complete immersion where my identity was so wrapped up in my bands that it wasn't really healthy.
Kathleen started getting sick on tour a lot, which happens. Do you know what I mean? Like, I get sick every tour, first day of the tour. It just happens.
I noticed her feeling depressed more than anything. And I think I noticed her having more and more sickness in terms of like losing her voice, getting strep throat, like whatever. And she was taking antibiotics a lot. I think that I did have some sort of sense of like the fact that she wasn't well.
I knew there was something wrong. For sure. I was really worried.
I struggled through the La Tigra tour dates that we had and everything we had planned and finished it.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you so much.
I sat down with Joe and JD and said, I can't do this anymore.
we all had lunch one day, and it was kind of just like, we all knew that something was gonna happen, but we weren't sure what. And Kathleen was like, I don't wanna do this anymore.
I kind of felt like spent in terms of writing songs. Like, I felt like I'd said everything I had to say up to that point.
Our last real headlining show was at Webster Hall in New York.
I lied when I said I was done. I knew I wasn't done. I just didn't want to face the fact that I was really sick. I wanted to have control over it. I wanted to tell everybody I chose to stop. But I didn't choose. I was told by my body I had to stop. But that was really painful for me to be told by anybody or anything what I could and couldn't do. So I told myself and told my bandmates and told my husband and told the world that I chose to stop playing music because I had nothing else to say. Because that felt better to me than being in touch with the fact that I might not ever be able to do the thing I love more than anything in the world.
Seeing just like all these different doctors trying to figure it out. And they were telling her all this different stuff, and they were doing all kinds of fucked up crazy tests. And, you know, they were like, the one that she had like some weird eye thing, and the doctor's like, oh yeah, it's probably lupus, or it could be MS. Like, just like all this fucking crazy shit. And you're like, what?
2008, the illnesses took a really weird turn.
Sex education through any.
I went to the Planned Parenthood march. I was not comfortable. I was having language problems.
Our next speaker was the lead singer for Bikini Kill. I feel like maybe I didn't say anything else. And the Tigra and the co-founder of the rap movement.
I couldn't hear out of the one ear, and I was like really struggling. All of a sudden, the sound changes in your head. I thought I was having a stroke. I couldn't talk, I couldn't communicate, and I was slurring like I was drunk. One side of my body felt numb. The paramedics thought that I had a minor heart attack. When I got to the hospital, the doctor asked me for all my symptoms, and at that point, I was like, I'm not gonna lie. I just was like, fuck it, I'm in the hospital. I'm just gonna tell this woman everything. She was just like, yeah, you're just having a panic attack because there's no way that you could be having neurological stuff and, you know, breathing difficulties and the stomach stuff. She's like, it's too many body systems to be involved, and there's no illness that has all those body systems involved. To be living with something and not knowing what it is really terrifying. I have late-stage Lyme disease, which means I've had Lyme disease for about 6 years.
When she came to see me, she had been ill for about 5 years. She actually recalled that she had been bitten by a tick back in 2005. And in fact, going through her history, she had been treated for Lyme disease.
I took antibiotics for 3 weeks afterwards. So when I got sick later, I never associated it with Lyme disease. And when it was brought up to me by different specialists, I said I already took the test.
You know, I would pull out my shitty ELISA test that's like the $20 test that the insurance company wants you to take, show it to doctors, and nobody said, oh, that's actually a crappy, totally unreliable test. But eventually I got a test called the Western blot test, and it lit up like a Christmas tree.
It's like if you were Superman and you met kryptonite, that's what Lyme disease is like.
I gotta take my pills.
When you start treating someone with Lyme disease, that person might get worse before they get better. It's kind of like you wake the sleeping giant when you use the antibiotic, and the infection kicks back even harder.
I just took my medication an hour ago, and I guess I'm having a reaction now to the infection and the medication meeting up or something. I'm filming this kind of because in the movie about me, I talk about having this disease and how it makes it so I can't do things. And obviously I can't like be on stage when I'm like this, and this isn't even as bad as it gets. And do I look normal?
No.
It doesn't feel normal right now, but I want to show what it's like because a lot of people get misdiagnosed. Like, I was misdiagnosed for 5 years. It invades like every part of your body, and then when you try to get rid of it, you have these really fucked up reactions, and you can't control your body or your speech, and it's real uncomfortable. So I'm filming it. I think that's good for now. We'll get a seizure later. I'm sure we'll get a seizure later.
I think we should do a few more takes.
I don't think people really saw her at her sickest. You know, it's just her and Adam.
More stressed out than I've been in a long time. Shit is crazy.
When you have an illness like this, it's hard to explain it to other people. The expectation out there is, okay, so you had Lyme disease. Yeah, you took antibiotics, you should be better. When you've had it for 5 years and it hasn't been treated, that's not gonna be the way that it works.
She never talked about her health or the pain she was in or anything.
Did you know she was sick?
I didn't know for a long time.
People who are running around being heroes act like they don't need help. That's the nature of being a hero. You don't need help, you're the helper.
There are moments where she knows that she can ask for help, but I don't think that that's necessarily an organic thing for her.
I realized I wanted to write a record when I started getting sicker and sicker and sicker. Because once I really was like pretty sure I couldn't do it, I really wanted it.
The thing that made me change or face it was that my illness was not only affecting me, it was affecting the people that I love.
I worked at a domestic violence shelter, and I remember women all the time saying I could take it, but when he started abusing the kids, I picked them up and left. They were like totally protective of their children, but they weren't protective of themselves. I saw it affecting Joe, how bad it affect Joe and JD and Adam, and I was like, it's not helping them that I'm minimizing this. It was just so much easier on everybody if I just faced what was happening, stopped blaming myself and fucking dealt with it. I called my new band The Julie Ruin, because it's kind of an outgrowth of the solo project I did in 99. It's really just different in that I'm not trying to write anthems or anything. I'm just writing songs and letting them be what they want to be.
Hey,
I feel embarrassed when people come up and tell me that I matter to them or something like that. And sort of like have all of these people like put on this show and like do covers of songs that I've sung. It feels like overwhelming and I haven't really been able to grasp it. Just all I've been through over the past few years and getting my diagnosis so close to this show. It's just when I was really sick, I would like sit around and be like, imagine people like being supportive and loving, because I never let that in before. And I had to learn how to do that because I was so sick for 5 years. And now it's like gonna be physical. Like I'm actually gonna go to this place and all these people are just gonna be totally loving and supporting me. And it's overwhelming. With the illness stuff, it means this extra thing that only my friends know about. So it's weird to be going to this public event where like people don't really know what I've been through. Yeah. Is everything turned off that nothing's gonna blow up? Is it something in a search of when I cannot hear you talk? Is it something sentimental?
Over here.
I just want to read this very special text by Kathleen. This is called Riot Girl Manifesto. Because us girls crave records and books and fanzines that speak to us, that we feel included in and can understand in our own ways. Because I believe with my whole heart, mind, body, that girls constitute a revolutionary soul force that can and will change the world for real. Thank you.
Hey everybody, thank you so much for coming. This is a really special night for me. So we're the Julie Ruin and we're writing a new album. Are you guys ready? What is the story of my life? I have no fucking idea. I just think there's this certain assumption that when a man tells the truth, it's the truth. And when, as a woman, I go to tell the truth, I feel like I have to negotiate the way I'll be perceived. Like, I feel like there's always the suspicion around a woman's truth, the idea that you're exaggerating. I don't just sit there and be like, this. There's this whole fear that I'm gonna have finally fucking stepped to the plate and told the truth, and someone's gonna say, I don't think so. If I wouldn't have admitted to myself that like the sexual abuse stuff that happened in my life, it wasn't just like one thing that happened when I was little and also how my dad treated me and blah, blah, blah. It was like all of these different things. Like, I would never want to tell everybody the whole entire story because it sounded crazy. It sounded just like too big of a can of worms. Like, who would believe me? And then I was like, other women would believe me. I don't give a shit what people think. I know what's real. I don't care if people don't think feminism is important because I know it is. And I don't care if people don't think, you know, late stage Lyme disease exists, because I have it and other people have it and we help each other and we know it exists and other people can think whatever they want. My problem is when people get in the way of feminism or people get in the way of people who are sick getting better because they don't understand it. And if they don't want to believe in it or they don't want to care about it, that's totally fine.
but they should have to stay out of my way.